Hi, everybody, and welcome to this episode of TensorFlow Meets. I'm absolutely delighted to be chatting with Chris Lattner. And Chris, I hear you're the inventor of this language that everybody's talking about, Swift.
Yeah, it's something I've been working on for some time. I guess my background is I've been working on compilers and tools for quite some time, worked on this LLVM compiler for a while. Yep. Swift is an awesome new language. It's got some really cool geeky language stuff on side of it, but the thing I love about it is designed to be easy to use.
Yeah, and it's that seems to be a lot of the passion around it is that even for new developers who are coming in, that it's like all of this easy to use kind of stuff for them.
Yeah, exactly. And so like the real goal here is to bring usability first and foremost. And this takes a lot of hard system engineering to make things feel easy, but it's absolutely worth it. And it's a great challenge.
So when it comes to now using Swift for TensorFlow, and it seems like I've started playing with it and kicking the tires a little bit, and I saw things like even like Keras layers are pretty straightforward. Could you tell us a little bit about like the thinking behind how you designed the API?
Yeah, absolutely. So Swift as a language has a lot of similarities to Python, and so wherever possible, we're trying to make the APIs feel the same because we want people to be able to learn one set of technologies and move back and forth without big roadblocks.
Right.
But on the other hand, Swift as a language has new capabilities and advantages that Python doesn't. It's just a lot newer. And so we want to be able to take advantage of that and build things out so it can be familiar yet powerful.
I see. Okay, cool. So one thing that may not be immediately apparent to developers or immediately understandable is this concept you spoke a lot about, differentiable code. And it's like, so it sounds like a really powerful thing, but can you help us understand a little bit more what it's all about?
Sure, absolutely. So this is a big differentiator for Swift for TensorFlow.
And I hear it's integral to the product.
Yeah, it's integral to everything we do. So if you think about machine learning models, when you define your forward function, you're defining and composing your model in this way, but then you need to train it. And so when you train it, what you end up wanting to do is compute the gradient of the values as they flow through your model and how they contribute to your loss.
Okay.
And so the way that works is through calculus. And calculus has this underlying principle called the chain rule. Chain rule is something that's been known for a really long time. And so what differentiable programming is doing is it's automatically computing this for you in the language.
I see.
And the cool thing about this is it makes it super extensible. So you can do new kinds of things and you can experiment and research new kinds of concepts. Or if you don't want to worry about that level of thing, you can just build on top of somebody else's libraries.
Right. So things like optimizers, like stochastic gradient descent, that kind of stuff.
Yes, they that's exactly how they work.
Yep. Right. So then it's a case of what I really like and what I find interesting in this is that instead of just trusting those libraries, it gives you the tools to be able to, because your code is differentiable, to be able to build your own or to at least understand what's going on.
Yeah, exactly. And again, this comes back to the principle of making it so that everything is an open box. And so you can look in and you can get around, you can customize and tweak and change, and everything is right there for you to play with.
Right. So it's one of the things I really like about Swift for TensorFlow in particular is that you can come in right at the top and just build your layers in Keras and train. And maybe that's all you'll ever want to do. But if you really need to kick the tires and see what's going on underneath, and even people like me who've forgotten more calculus than they probably ever learned.
Me too. Yes, I agree. Yes.
But if I do brush up on my calculus and I really want to tweak and optimize and that kind of stuff, then it's all there for me.
Yeah, and that's the idea of this no boundaries. You can go wherever your inspiration takes you. The thing I found about researchers is they don't want to have artificial boundaries. They don't want to say, like, I can do this much in Python and then I have to switch to C++ to do more.
Right.
If you can make it continuous, you can make it so that, you know, by being a seamless experience, you can enable more things to practically happen just because it's more natural and easy, and you're removing those barriers.
And you can trust your debugging more, right? Because you're not thinking about maybe something changed crossing a barrier.
Yeah, you don't have to switch debuggers in some cases.
Cool.
Yeah.
Now, one of the things, maybe it's related to that, but one of the things that also impressed me that when you showed in your talk was really interoperability, that I can just pull Python stuff in or I can pull like other stuff in. It's like, could you tell us a bit more about
that? Sure. So Swift works very naturally with C, and the way it does that is that it pulls in the Clang compiler directly into Swift and it interoperates at a very low level of the compiler with this. Python, on the other hand, is a super dynamic language. And so Swift has now, we've implemented new dynamic language features in Swift to allow it to directly talk to the Python runtime. And so when you're using Python in Swift, you're not using wrappers or some weird Python-esque thing. You're using real Python right in Swift. And one of the things I love about that is it gives you perhaps the world's best progressive typing system for Python also.
Right.
Because you can use a Python dictionary, or you can use a Swift dictionary of Python objects, or you can use a Swift dictionary of Swift strings and Python objects.
Wow.
And you can choose whatever level of Python that you want. And it's really natural and it just composes properly.
Super cool. Now, a lot of people, of course, will know Swift from it being like for iOS development.
Yes.
But of course, it goes beyond iOS development now with TensorFlow. And could you give us like some guidance and where's the best place to get started?
Yeah, well, so Swift is a cross-platform language, and a lot of iOS developers use it for sure, but it's also been very popular on the server, for example. And so a lot of people have been building Linux servers and things like that, which is really great for. If you want to get started, the easiest place to go is to go to github.com/TensorFlow/Swift, and we have a nice landing page, and we have all the information. You can join our community, and there's tons of information there that you can get going.
Right.
One of the really cool things is that all the demos we showed are available in Colab, and so you can use it on any device, a Chromebook, anything that you have. It just works.
Cool. And I know you've been working on a training course with the folks from fast.ai, so that if we want to be trained in Swift, we can go there too. Right?
Yeah, absolutely. So we're just getting that off the ground. I'm really excited about that. I'm a little bit terrified about that as well, but I'm sure it'll be really great, and I'm looking forward to working with Jeremy Howard.
Oh, I'm sure. I met him this morning, and he's awesome. So
he's so passionate.
Yeah,
it's great.
Definitely. So thank you so much, Chris. As always, this was amazing. Yeah. As always, it was inspirational. So, and thanks everybody for watching this episode of TensorFlow Meets. If you have any questions for me, if you have any questions for Chris, please leave them in the comments below. And we'll also put links to everything that we spoke about in this show in the comments below so that you can follow them from there. So
sounds
thanks
great.
Again, Chris.